Hello, and welcome to Mental Health Matters. Today we're doing an introduction to mental health in autistic children and youth. I'm Danielle Nolan, and I'm the social worker on our subject matter expert team here at Autism Ontario, and I'm joined by my colleague, Bethany. Bethany, can you introduce yourself, please?
Thanks, Danielle. My name is Bethany Bruin, and I am an occupational therapist and also part of our subject matter expert team here at Autism Ontario.
Here is our agenda for today. We will be introducing mental health and autism as co-occurring conditions. We will be briefly touching on self-regulation, and then we're going to talk about lifestyle, environmental, and brain-body factors that can influence mental health. And lastly, we'll be starting to talk about how you can support your child or youth's mental health. Let's start with what is mental health. SickKids provides a broad definition of mental health as emotions, cognition, and behaviors that vary in response to stress and resilience. This definition shows that mental health includes lots of things, including our feelings, thoughts, and our external behaviors. Every person is unique, and their presentation of mental health concerns is also unique. Autistic people may struggle with mental health in ways that are visible or not, and they may express their distress in different ways than neurotypical people. Mental health challenges can affect how a person communicates, including their body language, facial expressions, and their tone of voice, and even how they describe their experiences. Autistic children and youth may not appear to have anxiety, depression, or other mental health concerns, including a crisis, but they might be. We know that more than 50% of autistic teens meet the criteria for a co-occurring mental health condition. Co-occurring conditions are when people with autism also have another diagnosis or condition at the same time. These include anxiety, depression, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, or ADHD, and bipolar disorder. Researchers are starting to speculate why there is this high prevalence of co-occurring mental health conditions among autistic people. Some reasons might be that autistic people experience increased stressors related to their conditions, such as sensory sensitivities or the stress of masking their autistic traits. Masking is when an individual seeks to hide or minimize autism traits to fit in. They may struggle more with self-regulation, which we're going to talk about next. Their feelings of anxiety or stress may be more intense than their neurotypical peers. And they're less likely to be appropriately diagnosed with a mental health condition because their diagnosis of autism is overshadowing these symptomologies. With all of this in mind, it's important as parents and as caregivers that we talk about how to best manage autistic children's stressors and to help them build skills in self-regulation and how to cope with feelings of anxiety and stress. We're going to have to talk briefly now about the buzzword self-regulation. We know that self-regulation is an important skill for autistic children to learn, as it relates as to their ability to learn other skills and to promote independence. I'm going to play this quick and silly video now, and I hope it makes you smile.
Oh, nom, 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 nom.
I know it's a bit of a silly video, but self-regulation is a hot topic that comes up in social media, parenting books, and in general conversation. Self-regulation skills are considered a hallmark or significant contributing factor towards positive mental health and well-being. Because when we talk about mental health in children, we are often talking about them being able to stay calm or regulated, while dysfunctional regulation presents as those upset feelings, and this contributes to mental health. When we are asking our children to self-regulate, we're asking them to control both their feelings and their actions and be calm and alert enough to take in new information. Like in the video, the Cookie Monster has to stay calm and wait before he can have a cookie. And as Cookie Monster says, this is really hard. It requires various skills that may not develop until your child or youth is well into their teen years or even adulthood. To be able to effectively self-regulate, your child or youth needs to have an internal awareness of how they feel in their body. Then they need to match that to an emotion word or label. We call that emotional literacy. And then they need to find a way to resolve that feeling or that emotion. For example, we might notice a tight feeling in our chest and our heart might be racing. And this tells us that we're anxious. And then we make the decision to seek out the comfort of a loved one or have a drink of water. But this is a lot of step for kids. Throughout this webinar series, we are going to talk about how you can support your autistic child with all of these steps, as well as what you can do as a parent to help reduce the need for self-regulation. Stuart Shanker did a whole webinar on self-regulation for Autism Ontario, and the link's on your resource list if you're interested. I'm going to pass it off to Bethany now, who's going to talk about some lifestyle factors.
Thanks, Danielle. One of the first considerations when looking at our child's overall health, including their mental health, is lifestyle factors such as sleep, nutrition, or diet, and exercise. While managing these factors may seem like common sense, difficulties or differences in any of these areas can often have a drastic impact on your child's ability to cope with small and big stressors throughout their day. If you have concerns with any of these lifestyle factors, you may want to reach out to your medical or therapy team for support. We'll also be talking about some of these strategies related to lifestyle or environmental factors, including how we structure our daily routines as part of our upcoming presentations in this series. So now let's take a look at what we're calling brain and body factors and how these relate to mental health. So if we recall that our mental health is defined as how our emotions, so our feelings, our cognition or thinking, and our behaviors or actions, they may vary in response to stress or challenges, then we want to consider what's happening in our brain and in our body and how these brain and body factors can relate to our ability to regulate ourselves or to respond in different ways to different situations. So first of all, how are the brain and body connected? The brain and body communicate by sending messages back and forth to each other through our nervous system. For example, our body receives messages from the outside world, sights, sounds, and other information. Our brain then interprets these messages and then responds with an action or a behavior. Next, what does brain development look like at different ages? When children are very young, these messages and connections are developing very quickly, and they start to inform how the child perceives the world around them. Is it a scary place or a safe place? As children get older, these connections are revised through a process called pruning, and our brain is not really fully mature until our mid-20s. Our brain is still changing as we learn and have experiences throughout our life. Finally, how does behavior in our body reflect what is happening in our brain? We can use the actions or behaviors that we see in our child as clues to help us guess what might be happening in their brain. For example, are they responding from a calm and regulated state where their actions are intentional or on purpose? Or are they responding from a place of fear or excitement or dysregulation where their actions are more like an instinct? So next, we are going to watch a clip about a model that was developed by a doctor called Dan Siegel. He's a well-known brain scientist and is the author of the parenting book, The Whole Brain Child. This clip will tell us about what happens when we experience something that our brain and body perceive as a challenge or a stressor or a threat, and then how our brain and body respond with what he calls flipping our lid, or what we might call a meltdown.
You probably know the name Dan Siegel. He's one of the giants in the field of interpersonal neurobiology, and Dan came up with a lovely hand model of the human brain. So let's kind of go through the hand model of the brain. And this can be useful for you to understand, but at times it might be useful for you to actually share this with your client. The wrist, the forearm coming up to here, is like your spinal cord. And right here at the end of the wrist is like the base of your skull. And here, the bottom of your palm, this is like the reptile brain, the life support system of the brain. So, you know, if the rest of your brain is wiped out through, say, for example, a stroke or a car accident, this life support part of your brain, the reptile brain, can still keep your body alive, can still keep all your organs functioning and your breath and your heart and so forth. And this is where a lot of autonomic nervous system operates and stems from, this reptile brain. Now, above the reptile brain is the mammalian brain, often called the limbic brain or the emotional brain. So reptiles, they've got the fight or flight response, or they've got the freeze, shut down, flop and drop response, but they don't really have anything that is even remotely close to the complex emotional states that we see in mammals. And the limbic brain has many different parts to it, but two in particular that we'll be looking at in this course are the amygdala and the hippocampus. Now, don't worry about memorizing those terms for now. We will revisit them later. But this kind of is the middle brain, the limbic brain, the mammalian brain, basically responsible for emotions. Now, on top of the limbic mammalian emotional brain, you've got the cerebral cortex, the thinking cap of the brain. The cerebral cortex is much thicker in mammals, but especially so in primates, and particularly so in human beings, more so than any other primate. And this cerebral cortex, the thinking part of the brain responsible for consciousness and cognition. And right at the front of the cerebral cortex, you have the prefrontal cortex, the part of your brain that's right up here at the front of your forehead, above your eyes. And particularly important to us is the medial prefrontal cortex, this bit in the middle, right at the front, this bit up here. This plays a very important role in mindfulness and awareness. So let's just go through it again. You've got your spinal cord, you've got your reptile brain, underneath your cerebral cortex, you've got your mammalian brain with the amygdala, the hippocampus, responsible for emotions, and then you've got your cerebral cortex, your thinking cap of the brain on top, and the medial prefrontal cortex right here in the center at the front, right there.
That clip was helpful in understanding a bit more about how our brain and body may be responding during times of stress or challenge. Next, we're going to talk about what we call sensory processing, or our awareness of and interaction with the world around us. Before children can learn to regulate themselves during times of stress or challenge, they need to have an understanding of what is happening around them in their environment and how this information from their external environment can have an impact on their brain and their body. This process is called sensory integration or sensory processing, and is defined as an individual's ability to organize, integrate, and process sensory information received from inside the body and from the external environment to produce purposeful and goal-directed responses. In other words, this is the process of taking in information through our senses and then organizing this information to create an appropriate response. So we take in lots of input from our different sensory organs. Our eyes, our ears, our nose, our tongue, our skin, even our inner ear has a vestibular or balance sense, and we have receptors in our muscles and joints as well. And they're all processed in different areas of the brain. And then this information is shared between areas of the brain through a process called functional integration. Through this process, our senses are constantly interacting with the environment and with our brain to help us understand, where am I? What am I doing? What do I want? What do I need? And how will I react? A specific area of sensory processing that's been receiving a lot of attention recently in the autism world is called interoception. This is the perception of sensations from inside the body, and it includes the nervous system activity related to emotions. The sense of interoception is hard at work all the time, monitoring our entire body. Body parts like our heart, our lungs, our stomach, our bladder, muscles, skin, even our eyeballs, and collecting information about how these body parts feel. This sense helps to cue us to understand things like feeling hungry or feeling tired, and also cues us into connecting with our emotions. Research shows that understanding our bodily sensations is the first step to emotional awareness and self-regulation. So just to review and connect these ideas of our external awareness or sensory processing and our internal awareness or interoception to our discussion around mental health and autism, you might remember that we define mental health as how our emotions or feelings and cognition or thinking and behaviors all vary in response to stress or challenges. So when our brain and body process information from those internal and external environments, the way we process this information can contribute to our feelings of calm or upset. Now I'll invite Danielle to review some general parenting strategies we can use to support our children's mental health.
As Beth said, we're now going to shift our conversation over to what you can do to support your child's mental health, regardless of their age. So the SickKids Psychiatry Department developed a whole program around supporting mental health, and they emphasized these six parenting techniques. Be engaged. Your child needs you to play with them. They need you to listen when they're talking about something that interests them, and they need to know that they matter. Be sensitive. Your child is growing and learning and will sometimes need space to explore the world at their own pace. Be consistent. We'll talk about this more throughout our series, but keeping a routine and maintaining boundaries is critical to your child's development. Be responsive. Your child may want to exert their independence, but they still need you. Be enjoyable to be with. I know that this sounds straightforward, but it can actually be really hard to stay upbeat and fun as a parent. We're exhausted and often juggling multiple priorities. It's important to remind ourselves to slow down and have fun with our kids and be their voice. You are your child's voice, and they need you to label their thoughts, feelings, and experiences. And they need them repeated many, many times before they can start to do this themselves. One specific way we implement some of the SickKids strategies to support your child is called co-regulation. Before they can build the capacity for self-regulation, children need to have sustained experiences of emotional co-regulation with a caring adult or adults. Co-regulation is having our emotional and physical needs met by a caregiver. And these consistent experiences help to build that strong brain-body connection that Bethany talked about. Before children and youth are able to build their own self-regulation and coping skills, they depend on their parents and caregivers to do it for them. As adults, we continue to co-regulate with those around us, such as when we vent after a really long day to a trusted person, or when we have a co-pilot or a navigator in the car. And for our kids, this co-regulation happens every day in our interactions. When young children are soothed through hugs and rocking in a calming tone, to school-age children who need their parents to hold their hand as they transition into school or a recreation setting. And as teens, when they need to hear calm reassurance from their parents before they take a risk. Co-regulation is the foundation for healthy well-being and positive mental health across the lifespan. Staying calm and connecting can seem straightforward, but life is not straightforward. Life can feel chaotic sometimes, and this can be hard to do. I'm going to show this cute video now about active listening, and I think it shows how we can best be that calm support person that our children need.
No! No, 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 you can't take my rocket to the dust! Riley and I go to the moon! Riley can't be done with me.
Hey, it's gonna be okay. We can fix this. We just need to get back to headquarters. Which way to the train station?
I had a whole trip planned for us.
Hey, who's ticklish, huh? Here comes the tickle monster.
Hey, Bing Bong, look at this. Oh, here's a fun game. You point to the train station and we all go there. Won't that be fun? Come on, let's go to the train station.
I'm sorry they took your rocket. They took something that you loved. It's gone. Forever.
Sadness. Don't make him feel worse.
Sorry.
It's all I had left of Riley.
I bet you and Riley had great adventures.
Oh, they were wonderful. Once we flew back in time, we had breakfast twice that day.
Sadness!
It sounds amazing. I bet Riley liked it.
Oh, she did.
We were best friends.
Yeah, it's sad.
I'm okay now. Come on, the train station is this way.
Most importantly, we always like to highlight the importance and benefits of a positive social relationship in building self-esteem and improving mental health. Being lonely or feeling isolated can lead to feelings of anxiety in childhood, and this can continue into adulthood. This is one of my favorite quotes of all time. To the world, you may be one person, but to one person, you may be the world. For children with neurodiversities, building relationships can be hard, but it only takes one connection, one friend, one sibling, one coach, one teacher, one relationship to make a big difference. Thank you so much for joining us today, and stay tuned for the rest of the series that will include strategies for different ages and developmental stages. Have a great day.